Between the years 1560 and 1582, one name can sum up the events of feudal Japan: Nobunaga. For 22 years, Oda Nobunaga had risen to prominence and cemented a grip over the nation, with his ultimate aim being, in time, the inevitable end to the warring age known as the Sengoku Jidai, and the ushering in of a new era of peace under his clan. If successful, Japan today would no doubt look vastly different. However, as we know, in that fateful year of 1582, at the height of his power, he would be betrayed and forced to kill himself at the Temple of Honnoji, ending the age of Nobunaga and opening the door for a successor to in time take his place and finish the work he had started, uniting the land. So, with this monumental event now past, let us take a look back over the second phase of the Sengoku Jidai series, the chapter dedicated to Oda Nobunaga. We picked things up at episode 19, after the end of the first phase of the series. It is here we witnessed the man who would one day come to be known as Tokugawa Ieyasu return home to Mikawa, free from the shackles of the Imagawa clan. With Imagawa Yoshimoto's defeat at Okehazama, Ieyasu was free to make his clan independent once more, and then make efforts to secure its future for years to come. In episode 20, we turn to the capital, as with the death of Miyoshi Nagayoshi, the shogun Ashikaga Yoshiteru attempted to break free from Miyoshi influence, only to later be slain by a combined force of Miyoshi and Matsunaga. Episode 21 showcased the continued rise of Nobunaga, who seized a prime opportunity to invade and secure his neighboring province of Mino, at the same time giving rise to the legend of his faithful retainer, Hashiba Hideyoshi. With the shogunate in shambles, episode 22 displayed how another member of the Ashikaga family, Ashikaga Yoshiaki, would in time, through the aid of Akechi Mitsuhide, find a new ally within Oda Nobunaga who would deliver him to the capital, ultimately allowing the Oda clan to establish a new mighty regime. There would be pushback, however, as in episode 23, the Azai and Asakura clans would oppose Nobunaga. They would all come to clash at the massive battle of Anegawa, in which the Oda clan would win. However, they would be halted in their campaign. Episode 24 showed us a more cruel side of Nobunaga, as he was facing continued threats from the Ikoiki and other groups of militant monks. He would eventually lash out and massacre thousands of monks and civilians atop Mount Hiei, while also burning the historic temple to the ground. By episode 25, the situation was growing dire for Shogun Ashikaga Yoshiaki as he tried to remove the Oda from power and allow him to regain his independence. Eventually, he would find a new champion in Takeda Shingen, who would march west against the Oda, first coming to clash against the Tokugawa clan at Mikatagahara. It is here Shingen would completely crush Tokugawa Ieyasu. Yet, his victory would be all too brief, as soon he would suddenly and surprisingly die. In episode 26, Nobunaga finally had the ability to move against the Azai and Asakura in aims to fully defeat them, as both clans would in time be utterly eradicated by the armies of the Oda. We turn south in episode 27 as we witnessed the new rise of both the Shimazu in Kyushu and the Chosokabe in Shikoku, as both powers would in time come to dominate their regions. Episode 28 showcased perhaps one of the most important battles in world history, as Oda and Takeda forces finally came to clash at the monumental Battle of Nagashino. It is here Nobunaga would revolutionize matchlock warfare in Japan and completely cripple the Takeda, who had once been one of the mightiest powers in the entire country. In episode 29, Nobunaga's power would be checked by another of the most legendary figures of the period, Uesugi Kenshin, who would surprisingly crush Nobunaga at the Battle of Tedorigawa. Unfortunately, his victory would amount to little, as soon he too would die. With a new war having broken out between the Oda and the powerful Mori clan of the West, episode 30 showed the initial stages of the Oda campaign westward, as armies under Hashiba Hideyoshi and Akechi Mitsuhide began pushing their way into Mori territory. Episode 31 returned to the south as we checked back in with the Shimazu and Chosokabe as they continued to expand their influence over their respective islands. In episode 32, we witnessed the fallout after the death of Uesugi Kenshin, as his clan became shattered through a brief but devastating civil war, which would result in not only a loss in power, but a major loss in territory, which would completely reshape the balance of power in the East. Episode 33 displayed the final stand of the Takeda, as both Oda and Tokugawa armies pushed their way into Kai to finish them off, resulting in not only their fall, but also a new independence for the soon-to-be significant Sanada clan. And finally, episode 34 would illustrate the final moments of Nobunaga's rule, as in aims to move west to aid Hideyoshi in ending the war against the Mori, he would leave himself vulnerable in Kyoto, where he would be betrayed by Akechi Mitsuhide, who would completely shatter the power of the Oda just when Nobunaga was on the verge of his ultimate victory. So there you have a brief recap of Nobunaga's phase of the Sengoku Jidai series. His impact will forever be remembered as he begun the hard process towards a unification of the land. And although the groundwork towards peace has been laid, there are still plenty of obstacles to come. As in the wake of his death, a new period of turmoil appears on the horizon. In the coming chapter, we will witness the rise of Nobunaga's successor and his path towards his unification of Japan. However, do not be fooled by the potential prospect of a coming peace, as we shall indeed come to see a greater ambition looms far off on the shores of a distant land, an eventual conflict which will come to have a major impact on the outcome of the Sengoku Jidai. Thank you so much for watching, and thank you for joining me on this journey thus far.